Hello again, this is Charles Anderson. I've done a series of videos on how to use Aspen Custom Modeler, and I realized that most of those videos have focused on the nuts and bolts of writing the code and a sort of developer perspective. I thought what I might do is a quick video on some of the ways in which ACM gets used and sort of a higher level overview of what the results might look like. To do that, what I've done is I've come up with a very simple flow sheet. It doesn't represent reality, and I know that it's not a full-blown process, but hopefully it's useful enough for demonstrations. What I've got is a slurry coming in, which is a mixture of clay, product, and water. And I'm going to run that through one tank into a second tank. In that second tank, I'm going to add some chemical, which combines with the clay so that in the separation step downstream, I can separate the clay from my product and water and come up with a very simple flow sheet along those lines. Very simplistically, I've defined the recovery of clay. I'm saying 90%, up to 90% of the clay can be recovered, and that's a function of how much the product of the concentration of chemicals times the concentration of clay, and I've fitted that to a simple parabolic curve, thrown that into a custom model in ACM, so that there I have that same parabolic equation basis, the product of the chemical concentration and the clay concentration. Okay, so with that all set up, I can then have a look and say, given this feed composition, I'm going to have a certain flow rate of clay. That's going to give me a certain flow rate and composition of my waste stream and a flow rate and composition of my final product. So you can see at this base case where I'm using 10 kilos an hour of chemical, I'm getting 145 kilos of waste, and my product concentration is 21.7%. If I use 15 kilos of chemical an hour, so I'm using more chemicals, you can see that moves from 145 to 185 of waste leaving the system, and my concentration has gone up to 22.2%. So I'm getting slightly more of my product recovered into the valuable stream. Kind of difficult tracking variables across all these different tables. So what I can do is create a flow sheet level summary table where I can drag variables off of this these individual tables associated with the flow sheet, with the unit operations and streams on the flow sheet. And I can then put all those together into a single table. So in this case, what I've got is a single table where I've got the flow and composition of the slurry coming in, the mass of chemicals being added, the material going into my separation tank, and then the performance of the separation, the flow of my waste and composition, flow and composition of my product. So it's all together in one table. So now if I move that number again, it's easier to see how this is 184, 22.24. They're on the same table, so it's slightly easier to see how those things have moved around. Of course, what I'd like to do as well is have equations that point at multiple variables, and so I've done that over here. I've got a yield calculation where I'm saying the yield of product is the mass fraction times the flow rate in slurry 3, the stream leaving, divided by the mass fraction times the flow rate in the stream coming in. Notice I don't have to use traditional programming. I can use engineering type equations, and I can avoid divide by zeros by having multiple variables on the left-hand side of the equation. Similarly, I'm defining the dry basis inlet concentration of product and inlet outlet concentration of product, so the dry basis in these two streams. So if I have a look in this table, you can see I'm getting 93.9% yield at a concentration of 81.3 on a dry basis in my product with 10 kilos. If I go to 15, we'll see that the yield drops slightly, but the concentration increases significantly. And so let's assume that I need this to be at least 90%, I can iterate to get this to the value that I want it to be. But one of the powerful things about ACM is I can change the structure. So it's interpreting these equations on the fly. And so I can actually change the mathematical structure of the model and say, rather than I know the chemical coming in, calculate the discharge concentration, what I can do is I can say, calculate the amount of chemical that I need to add in order to achieve an overall product concentration on a dry basis of 90%. And so you can see that restructures the model in the background, and now I know exactly how much chemical I need to achieve 90% product in my final material. Okay, so that demonstrates very quickly the basis of what steady state simulation can do in ACM. Hopefully that gives you a flavor. Obviously, with the ability to put large complex equations into the flow sheet, I can overlay economics of the process. I can potentially size equipment. I can set up much more complex recovery type calculations with things like yield or economics in there. I can then sort of optimize, you know, minimize the overall cost or maximize the overall yield by varying certain variables. And so ACM supports all that sort of stuff with steady state simulation. The next piece I want to look at, though, is dynamic simulation. So let me change the layout of my screen slightly to have a look at that. Okay, what I've done now is I've set up a graph where I'm looking at the concentration going into the tank, out of this tank, out of this tank, and out of my final separator. That's plotted here in this graph. In this graph, I'm looking at the dry basis concentration of product on the inlet and the outlet and that overall yield that I had calculated. And in this graph, I'm looking at the flow rate of chemical into the system. So the first thing I'm going to do is to say, okay, I've started the whole system off at steady state with 10 kilos an hour of chemical. I want to adjust that and see how the system changes. So I could do that on the fly, but because this is a demo, I wanted to make sure it was consistent. So what I've done is I've written a task where it waits for an hour, then moves that chemical concentration up to 26 kilos an hour, waits for 20 hours, and then pauses to see what's happened. So let me do that. I set it off running. Oh, I've got to switch it into dynamic mode to make it work. So I set it off running, and you can see at 1 hour, it takes a step change in the chemical load. And you can see that immediately starts to impact the dry basis concentration of the product out. You can see it momentarily spikes the yield up, and then it bounces the final product concentration up. The yield initially spikes, and then it comes back down again. And it's settling out in that sort of 20-hour time frame. So this starts letting me see if I have a disturbance in the system or if I take a control action, how long does it take the system to stabilize and equalize? So you can see it's really still not quite at steady state after 20 hours, but it's pretty close after sort of 8 to 10 hours. That gives me a feel for the dynamics of my system. Okay, the next thing to think about is, well, okay, I've assumed that the concentration of clay on my inlet, is constant. What happens if that varies? So what I'm going to do is go back to time zero. I'm going to turn off my simple step test, and I'm going to set up a task where I wait for a little bit, then over the course of 6 hours, ramp my concentration of clay from the starting 10% down to 5%. Then over 10 hours, ramp it up to 20%. Then over the next 3 hours, ramp it back down to 10%. And so I've got a disturbance in my flow rate of clay. I can then activate this task where what I do is I take that same step change to what I thought was my ideal concentration of chemical going in. Then I run that variation in the clay profile and I see what that does as a function of time. So let's set that off running. You can see because I'm changing my clay concentration, my product concentration is varying. I get a nice ramp out of the in the feed stream that's damped by a first order decay coming out of the residence time of that second tank, and then another first order decay, so second order decay on slurry concentration too. So you can see how that concentration is varying in each of my tanks and what that's doing to my final product. You can see again my step change, and then I'm not changing anything as a function of time. And you can see My yield takes, I don't know, it's about 9-10 hours to reach that 90%, to certainly get over 90%, and it drops back down again at that 19-hour time frame. So I've got a period here where I am in specification, but I've got a tail here that's not great that I'd like to maybe deal with. Okay, so how could I do that? Well, so what I'm doing at the moment is I'm not taking any control action. What I could do with the steady state model that I had before is I could actually run it a number of times, varying that clay concentration. So this is at steady state. And I can then say, in order to maximize my performance of the separator, what amount of chemical do I need? So I've calculated the amount of chemical using my ACM model and then fitted a simple correlation to that in Excel. So I've used the steady state model to develop an advisory control scheme, essentially, for the amount of chemical dosing. Yes, there's lots of ways I could do this better if I was doing this for an industrial case. This is just for a demo. So I've got another quadratic equation that I can put in ACM. Then I can encode that into my flow sheet level. And so there I've got that quadratic equation, and I'm going to get an ideal flow rate basis, the incoming concentration of clay, and I'm going to plot that down here in the second graph, in the third graph rather. The other thing I'm going to do is I'm going to activate this task, which now is going to have that clay variation, but also the dose adjustment task running in parallel. For that dose adjustment, what I'm doing is I'm setting the flow rate of chemical in equal to that ideal flow rate that we just calculated, that I'm waiting 2 hours and taking another adjustment, waiting 2 hours and taking another adjustment. So I'm going to have a stepwise feed-forward control system and see what that does for this system. And so you can see here's my system taking those steps, hitting the ideal case every once in a while. You can see I now get to my target at 5 hours, and I stay above that target of 90% concentration until 22, 23 hours, and I just sneak below it at the end of my time frame. So it looks like this is an interesting control scheme. This is something we might want to try and do. This is obviously maybe not industrial scale yet, but hopefully what I'm doing is giving a flavor for how to configure and set up the system to do some dynamics. The last thing I'm going to do is to say, well, okay, I'm using this concentration for my feed-forward loop. Possibly this concentration, which has got a first-order lag on it, is a better option for what I should be doing. So let's see what would happen if I change my task to use that. This concentration here. Case 3 I'm not going to show you, but that's using the discharge here as the control scheme. In this case, I'm going to use slurry 2. And this ends up being the best option. You can see I'm taking less severe steps than if I were using the inlet concentration, because it's basis the red line, not the green line. But now you see it takes me slightly longer to get up to steady state, because I start off at a very poor starting point, and the previous example just fortuitously got me close initially. But now once I'm in control at 6 hours, I stay in control or above my spec for the whole 25-hour period, and I'm taking less severe control actions. So hopefully that lets you see some of the things you can do with steady state and dynamic simulation. Thank you for listening. I appreciate it when people leave likes. It's nice to know that people are paying attention. And any comments you have, I'd be happy to try and respond. Thank you very much.